Hello and welcome back. We're here at Norwich Packers, to meet Matthew Heleniak, who's the third generation of this family-owned business who's raising beef. Matthew's going to tell us about how they raise a quality product, a quality local product, right here in Oxford County. We are going to look at how NorPac is controlling the supply chain right from the hooves on up.
Yes.
How's that take place?
Well, it takes place, I guess, and we start on the pastures with cows and calves, and we buy the cows and calves, or the calves, I guess, after they come off the calves, in the springtime. We put them into our feedlots. We feed them a very high-quality fed diet of corn-based diet, because we're involved with kind of the corn-fed program, and one part of our program is that. And then also we have an antibiotic and hormone-free program, which I could talk about later. But, yeah, we bring those cattle into our feedlots. We treat them properly. We have them in packed barns here, I guess, so there's no concrete, so kind of nice, soft bedding for them, and then free choice feed. These calves arrived here, they came from northern Ontario approximately a month and a half ago. So when they came in, they probably weighed around 650 pounds. They've been on feed now for, like I said, that month and a half. So we usually say days, so about 50 days, 55 days on feed. These cattle are eating a whole corn diet, like I said before. It's balanced with a vegetarian pellet that has all the essential nutrients in it to balance the corn. So it's got the roughage in it. It has the minerals and the vitamins in it and anything else the animal needs for a healthy stomach. So that way they can eat the corn and make it very, very healthy for them. So,
what is it about corn that you like to feed these animals?
Well, corn creates a very palatable beef, so the beef has a very very good flavor, I guess, with almost exceptional flavor.
So you're feeding corn for us that consume the beef, not
yes.
for the animal.
Well, correct, too, but the beef also love it as well, right? So I always give the analogy, if you let a beef out in the open right now, where is it going to go? It's going to go to a cornfield and eat as much corn as it can, right?
Really?
So, yeah.
So are these animals all the same?
These animals are basically the same. For our purposes at Norwich Packers, we do a lot of exotic style cattle. So you'll hear the terms Angus out there quite a bit.
Yeah,
those
yeah.
are black cattle. We feed a lot of red cattle, which are Limousin cross cattle or exotic style cattle. They originate from France, and they're known to be a very tender beef, but also a leaner style of beef too, which bodes well for our customers because a lot of our customers like the leaner beef in Toronto. The people in Toronto like the leaner beef for the grocery chains. So.
But you've made a big change inside the shop here in terms of control the supply chain. Tell me why you're interested in hormone-free beef.
Well, the reasons that we, I guess, got into feeding cattle to begin with was my father recognized the fact that in the mid-90s, sometimes we would get short of our product. We really needed to buy cattle. We were forced to, I guess, buy cattle we didn't want to buy. We were also forced to deviate from our plan of creating a consistent product because you had to go outside the lines mm-hmm. of your normal, I guess, pool of people that you usually bought from. So what my dad wanted to do was kind of make sure that he controlled the source of the cattle so he could control the consistency of our beef products. So that's what he did in the 90s, created the high-quality beef feeding program with a guy named Dr. David Price out of New Mexico. He created this very great diet that we were able to feed for the cattle. And then it created, again, the results of that were having a very consistent product and also having product available to us on a daily basis. So if we were out there, say at certain times of year, maybe November, a lot of people don't have a lot of cattle out there, we had them available to us. So those are the two major aspects. One was consistency and quality. The other thing, just make sure we never ran short at all times because our customers want beef 365 days a year.
Yeah.
So.
And hormone, and stores do. Yeah,
yes,
you got a
yeah.
continuous supply.
Yeah.
So things like hormones?
Yeah, hormones are something we have different programs at Norwich Packers. We do have a hormone-free program and antibiotic-free program that the cattle are put on. So basically what hormones are, it's just a little extra hormone that's given to the cattle to help them grow at a faster rate. We've taken these out of a bunch of our cattle to make them grow more naturally. A lot of people want that. They want the hormones taken out. Even though hormones have been proven safe
wow.
throughout the world, a lot of people don't like the idea of them being in the cattle. So we do take them out and make people happy. It's a little bit extra cost for people because the cattle aren't growing as fast. They're eating a little bit more corn throughout their lifetime. However, people believe in that product and they'll pay a little extra for it. So.
We will return in a minute and a half with more from Norwich Packers. Stay with us. How much money do you expect to make off that 1,100-pound animal?
Well, these guys have a ways to go, yeah, right? So they're about, I believe these guys are about the 30, 35-day range. So we're going to feed them for about 120 days total. So definitely another 85 or 90 days that way. So they'll get quite a bit bigger. Then after that, we have to get the value out of that carcass. So
yeah.
we have to get probably, for us to make ends meet, anywhere from $2,200 to $2,300 after that to make any ends meet. And farming is legalized gambling, too, and same as the meat packing plants. So we always say just because it looks good on paper, doesn't always mean it's going to be that way. Sometimes you make money, sometimes you lose money. It's definitely an agriculture thing. There is definitely cyclical economies at work there. So 1 year you might make a lot, 1 year you might lose a lot. You just hope that you make more than you lose, I guess, at the end of the day. So.
Yeah, I don't know why sometimes farmers are smiling, because they hardly control anything. You don't control the weather, you don't control the farm gate income, you know, you control
everything. Yeah, everything is such a world market now, too. Yeah. So corn's a world market, cattle is a world market now, too. A lot of beef comes in from Australia nowadays, Uruguay, Brazil. So there's a lot of beef. I just read an article there yesterday that I think Ontario last year imported about $1 billion in beef itself. So, and we produce a lot of beef here to begin with, but we still brought in $1 billion of beef. Well, that's a lot of beef.
The beef that's raised here is generally consumed in Ontario?
Generally, I would say 90% is consumed in Ontario. So the other, well, maybe 10% would be Quebec, obviously, would have a lot of it. And there is some that does trickle to the States, too. So I guess 20, 25, 30 years ago, there used to be 40 or 50 meat plants. Now there's four of us left. So, and we're the smallest of those four. And the reason that we survived is because we do have a high quality product, or we feel we do. Obviously, it's proven to be that way as well, because we're still around. We have a high quality product, and people appreciate the fact that we have lean, tender beef. So, but we also have marbled beef that has been able to supply high-end restaurants and stuff as well. So we adapt to the customer's ability, whatever they want. We're a very service-oriented company as well. But like I said, it used to be 40, now there's four, and then anybody after us is huge corporations. You're dealing with Cargill, JBS, Tyson. We're talking world companies that are billion-dollar corporations. So,
but how can we get a look at or a picture of the amount of beef in the dairy capital of Canada? How much beef is really raised here?
Yeah, there isn't a lot of beef cattle raised in Oxford County anymore. Obviously, with the high value of cropping land here, it's kind of taking the pasture, I guess, out of the equation that way, and that's what beef want, or pasture, right? Our land is just too good to pasture cattle. There's too much money in the cropping end of it. However, dairy has always seemed to, I guess, definitely make great strides in this county, obviously, with the high quality of the land and stuff like that, able to grow triple, double crop stuff and things like that. So beef kind of, I guess, took a back seat to Holsteins in Oxford County. There is still quite a few cattle in Oxford County, though. There's a few farmers around here. I would say it's definitely dropped down to 20% from where it was 50 years ago. However, there is still quite a few beef. Numbers-wise, I don't know exact numbers, but we're probably... I know there is still quite a few farmers in Oxford County doing it, just not to the ways they
were. To the extent in the past. Yeah. But guess what? Next paddock over, dairy cows.
Yes, there are some dairy cows.
No, those are not dairy cows. Those are Holsteins.
Well, they're a dairy breed, and they're being raised for the beef market. Yeah. That's actually Gilbert, who owns this barn, Gilbert Van Kerbrook's barn. He is feeding these cattle for a guy, custom feeding them, and what he's taking is obviously the male Holstein cattle can't be used for milk or nothing like that. They have to be used for meat.
Even I know that.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good one, yeah. So, so they're used for meat. So what's happened with the veal market's obviously taken a hit over the last few years too. Most of the dairy cows used to go for veal. Now that market's dried up quite a bit, some people are raising them to full beef beef capacity, so they'll get to about 1,700 pounds at finish as well.
Really?
Too.
So yeah, they'll be heavier than these folks in this pen.
Yeah, they just don't work, I guess, as far as they eat a lot more and different things, so they definitely don't convert like beef cattle. They're not made for beef, I guess, per se, but they still work because you're able to buy them cheap.
How do people find you in Oxford County?
Well, there's a couple different ways you can find us. We do have a local retail store here in Norwich, so if you're local and stuff like that, you want to come down to a retail store, that's something you can do. We're not in a lot of big chain stores because they want to buy off the larger corporations. It's more of a price thing that way. Ontario Corn Fed Beef does have a very good program in Loblaws, so we're on the Ontario Corn Fed Beef program as well, too. So, but we're not into the Loblaws of the world. They're still dealing with the bigger companies. But we also have a website, www.norpacbeef.com. It's got some of our customers on there, so throw that little plug in there as well, so you can find our customers on there as well. We do supply a lot of high-end restaurants too. In Norwich, one of our good customers is 639 Restaurant. They do a very
In Woodstock.
Yeah, they support local product quite adamantly, so they have our steak on their menu there. So that's something that I guess a customer that we would supply that way.
But you also have, I was in your shop, you have corned beef.
Yeah.
You have pea meal bacon.
We make pea meal bacon, fresh sausages. We do a lot of further processing as well. That was something we had to adapt and do as well. I guess just kind of vertically integrate that way. So we do have some product. We do make a lot of fresh sausage as well. So we sell those to distributors. So a lot of restaurants do have our product. Probably ate NorPac beef a lot. Never realized that either too. So the biggest thing I can tell the people is ask for it by name, and they can find it for you. So.
quality brand, you know. When it comes to eating local, you have a choice, and you should be looking for brand name products, and NorPac being one of them. And thanks for the tour.
Yeah, no problem, anytime.
Yeah. So. We're above the fray here. They look very content at the moment, just like I am. And thanks for watching. I'm Mike Harding for Innovation Oxford. See you next time.